Good morning.
Good afternoon.
Good evening.
Or whenever you're watching, welcome to church. Thanks for joining us this morning. We're excited to share a wonderful service with you.
The Orchard newsletter is coming out in the coming weeks, so stay tuned for that. It'll be a great read as always, keep you updated on what's happening within the church community, so stay tuned for that in the coming weeks.
We also have something else exciting that's on its way. The community garden at our Bayswater campus is opening, and we have a very special sign. Look at this. So this will be at Bayswater, and the opening is happening on Sunday the 29th of August at 2 p.m. So yeah, make sure you're there to welcome in the garden. It'll be a very exciting time.
Okay, on to our Bible reading for this week. It comes from Luke chapter 7, verses 36 to 50, and it's about Jesus being anointed by a sinful woman. All right, 36. One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him. He went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And a woman in the city who was a sinner, having learned that he was eating in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster jar of ointment. She stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears and dry them with her hair. Then she continued kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment. Now, when the Pharisee who invited him saw it, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what kind of woman is touching him, that she is a sinner." Jesus spoke up and said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." "Teacher," he replied, "speak." "A certain creditor had two debtors and owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he cancelled the debts for both of them. Now, which of them will love him more?" Simon answered, "I suppose the one whom he cancelled the great debt." And Jesus said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has bathed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, for her sins, which were many, have been forgiven. Hence she has shown great love, but the one whom little is forgiven loves little." Then he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." But those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace."
It's a wonderful Bible story. Looking forward to hearing more about that later on. If you're a regular worshipper here, now is a great time to give your offering.
Also, our kids and young adults and youth programs are back in full swing as of this week. So we're back in person, which is really exciting. So if you've got young kids, you can come along to KidsQuest, or if you've got youth or young adults, bring them along to Emerge. We always have a great time learning about God and doing lots of fun activities.
That's about it from us. Our last thing we want to do is to pray to lead into the rest of our service. God, we thank you that we have the technology to bring our church online, to shift and to pivot to something different and something new. And we celebrate what we have, Lord, and we look forward to things changing and to being back in the building. But for the moment, we are thankful. God, we pray that each person watching this, whatever day and whatever time it is, feels impacted and feels your presence in their house or wherever they are. Thank you, God, for our offerings that are given today, and we pray for a wonderful week, and we look forward to many great blessings in each of our lives. Amen.
Amen. Thanks for joining us.
Heaven, you came running. There was mercy in your eyes. upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand.
Above the waves. My
Welcome everyone to our time of communion today. It might be this morning, this afternoon, or this evening that we're sharing this time together, but I'm just really glad that you're here with us today. So I've been pondering during the week about a story that some might have actually heard before about paying it forward. Have you ever heard of somebody going through the drive-thru and the car in front of them has paid for your meal? So it's a bit of a shock when that happens and you don't quite know what to do. Well, in the story that I was told, the person was prompted to pay for the three cars behind them. And I thought, three cars, you're pretty game. That's a whole lot of money you might have to spend. And I was told, it was late at night, not likely to be big family meals, I'm fine. When they came back to tell me what happened, the first car, they could hear the response, was like, wow, thanks, that's wonderful. The second car, no response at all. The third car, however, came and stopped as this person was waiting for their food, came and knocked on their window. Why me? Why did you pay for me? I don't understand. I haven't done anything good for you. Why me? Do we ever feel like that about communion? Why did Jesus die on the cross for me? What did I do? I haven't done anything special for him. Why do I deserve this? But that's one of those beautiful things that we have, that God has given to us, that no matter what we do or where we've been, we are still loved by him and he still died on the cross for us. Each week when we come to communion, we have a small piece of bread and a little cup of juice. It's something pretty simple and, you know, these days we walk into church and we're given it. At home, it might be a biscuit or toast that we're eating instead of bread. And it might be a cup of coffee that we're having instead of the juice. But as long as when we do this, we spend our time to focus on what God did for us through Jesus, it doesn't matter what we have in that space. But today, I invite you, no matter what you've done, where you've been, how hard life might have been for you this week, or this month, or this year, I invite you in the space that you're in to remember what Jesus did for us. We remember with the bread that his body was broken for us. And he asked us in his Last Supper to, every time we meet, share this and remember him. So this morning, let's take our bread and do just that. Jesus also took a cup and asked that when we drink this, we remember his blood shed for us. So let's drink this together. And as we remember that broken body and that spilt blood for us, but we also remember the life that came back that 3 days later, that is why we meet today, to remember not his death, even though that was for us, but the more important part, that he actually is alive with us today. And that's why we have opportunities to pay it forward to others, to remind them, to invite them into a meal. It might not be at the Lord's table like what we do here. Maybe it's at your table at home, and it makes an opportunity for you to have a conversation about why God did this for you. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the reminders that are put in our lives, like people
paying for other people's meals that just prompt us to remember what you did on the cross for us so many years ago. And we thank you that you are alive and walking with us today, and that that's what empowers us to be able to share a good news story, not one of death, but one of life with our friends. Amen.
And welcome to our time of wisdom in God's Word. Hope you're travelling okay in the middle of this season. We're in slightly changed circumstances to lockdown, little by little being released. But even so, we continue to go on with being the church. And so joining together this way is one of the wonderful ways that we can stay connected and we can journey in faith and discipleship together. So over the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about God's justice and his heart for justice, and we've been digging into different aspects of his Jesus' teachings, particularly around God's justice and his heart for the world. So we're going to carry that on again today as we talk about the topic, God is kinder than we think he is. Before we do, let's pray. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. We're so grateful you invite us to your table, to your table of communion, but not just your table of communion, to friendship with you, to sharing life together, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And we hold those truths. We hold that promise, that invitation, today as we come to your word, knowing, Lord God, that you want to continue to grow us in ourselves, in our faith, in our experience and our encounter with you. And today, as we read your word, as we look at your word, we ask that it wouldn't just be words, but that you would breathe your life, your revelation, your encounter upon us this morning or whenever we are watching this. And that we would, Lord God, move closer in our experience and encounter of you. We thank you, you promise, that when we draw near to you, you draw near to us. So we hold that as we dip into your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. Wow, what a funny title I'm starting with. God is kinder than you think. Maybe it's a funny title because you've been raised knowing that God is good and kind and merciful. And you might think, well, Becky, you're preaching to the converted here, not the choir, we don't have one of those, but you're preaching to the converted. We know God is kind. Maybe we'll just skip to the end, so you listen to your summary points and clock out. But actually, as I go along in life and in ministry, I'm meeting more and more people who are grappling with this tension of who is God? Is he kind? And they're reading the Old Testament and they're hearing and remembering stories and sometimes ill-equipped to really know the breadth of God. Maybe we haven't educated or taught them enough through our Sunday school years. Maybe we haven't taught them more than 5 or 6 Bible verses and preached from the same things over and over. And as a result, people's faith doesn't have the breadth of understanding of who God is and his kindness and his character. And so people are asking the question, can I trust God in times that are tough? Can I trust God? Is God really on my side? Is he really kind? And that's inside the church, let alone outside of the church. I've got lots of good friends that don't have faith yet. And they say to me, I grew up in the church and all I experienced was judgment. I grew up in the church and I was never good enough. I grew up in the church and everybody said one thing and did another. And I just don't know that God is really good. Why would I come back? And so there are a lot of people that are asking this question, and that's why in this conversation around justice and God's justice, we want to lean into this understanding that God is kinder than we think he is. For a long time, God has been packaged and wrapped up and presented as judgmental and wrathful and angry and violent and warmongering. And, you know, these things have been picked out and pulled out by pop culture and identified. And as a church, we're ill-equipped to actually see what God's priorities are. And so today, that's what we're going to talk about and why we're going to talk about it. So, we're going to begin in Luke. And I know we've read this passage, but I'm actually just going to read the first little bit. And I want you to pretend you've never, ever heard this story before. Here we go. Luke 7:36. When one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. And so she came with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. And then she wiped them with her hair and kissed them and poured perfume on them. And when the Pharisee, who'd invited Jesus, saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she's a sinner." I wonder if you know how the story ends. If you tuned into the introduction, you'll know we read it there, but maybe you skipped that or missed it, or were ducking out to get your communion items during the reading. Many of us, though, have actually grown up hearing this story, and so we know the story pretty well. Actually, just this week, I was talking to some of our young adults from church, and I said, oh, what happens in the end of the story? And they said, oh, you know, the sinful woman comes and cries and Jesus forgives her and blah, 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 blah. And I had a bit of a giggle because I thought that's what can happen. Sometimes with God's good news stories, when they become familiar and we don't step into them and we don't enter into them, we actually fail to experience what magnificent teaching and encounter God is bringing. And we blah, 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 these kind of stories. And yet these are the stories of where Jesus brings a revelation of God's justice. And so we've got to lean in and listen to the story. So it is easy for us to become so blah, blah, blah. Jesus is at the table reclining. And if you've grown up in the church, you'll think nothing of that. If you haven't grown up in the church, you may not have remembered that in Middle Eastern culture, they didn't sit on chairs up at the table with their chair tucked in if they were well-behaved Victorian-oriented people. They reclined and they laid on cushions and they ate off shared plates. And that's what Jesus was doing. Now, he clearly seems comfortable in this picture and he's surrounded by people that have invited him and they're having kind of familiar conversation. And yet into that room comes a woman and she's a local and she enters the room and she comes straight to Jesus and stands behind him. And I imagine she's standing, if he's lying like this, she's standing at his feet behind him. And as she's standing there, she's weeping and weeping. Can you imagine the scene? If you're one of those men that really hates it when women cry, you might already be feeling a bit uncomfortable by this story. I think the whole room was feeling a little bit uncomfortable. And as she's weeping, it goes just not just from a noise of weeping, but there are tears that are rushing down her face. And so much so that they drip off her face and they drop onto Jesus' bare feet and little muddy trickles are running down his feet. And so she bends to wipe his feet. And as she does, she uses her hair to wipe his feet and begins to kiss his feet. And everybody else in the room is gobsmacked. Nobody speaks according to the story. Nobody says anything. And this woman opens a special alabaster perfume and she pours it on Jesus' feet. The fragrance fills the room and nobody moves a muscle. And everybody's thinking something. And if you've ever been in a room where someone does something very odd, you'll know what that awkward, silent feeling is like, where everybody's thinking something but nobody wants to say the first word. But for people that have been rejected by the church or have experienced abuse in the church or have experienced people revealing a nasty expression of God rather than a true and kind expression, they may well know what the woman was feeling in that moment of silence. Maybe there was fear. What would happen next? Would they yell at her? Would they scream, get out? Would they condemn her? Would they beat her? All of these things were socially acceptable to do for people that were lower down in the food chain of Jewish society. And Simon's wondering, what will Jesus do? And he's poised, ready to act for whichever way Jesus leans. And I wonder what you think to yourself God should do here. What should God do in this space? And the answer that you come up with might reveal the way you have been raised to see and to know God. And if you think this should be a story about forgiveness and love, then you're probably raised in a church or in a culture, in a family, an experience or an encounter where you've experienced Jesus' love. But if you think judgment or harshness or laughter or embarrassment, something like that might happen, then maybe that tells you that you've experienced some of those things in your formation of who God is. the church I was raised in, we learnt of all the Gospels, John's Gospel most. And so maybe you're like me and you would go first to this idea of, well, sinful woman, let's pick up on that word. And John's Gospel is a gospel of forgiveness. And, you know, Jesus was called the Lamb of God who's taken away the sins of the world. So goodness, that's maybe where we need to go. We need to identify this woman's sin and then tell her that Jesus can take away her sin. And maybe then we'll jump into the Romans Road. I don't know if you know the Romans Road, but I was raised Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So you're a sinner, you've fallen short. But Romans 6 says, but the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. You can have eternal life even though you're a sinner. And then from there to Romans 12, you know, therefore give your life as a living sacrifice, renew your mind and begin to live into the life God has called you. And that's the pathway for many of us that we have been taught and formed to understand how to respond when somebody is carrying a burden of sin. And it's a redemptive kind of pathway. But curiously, Jesus doesn't go down the John and Romans pathway, neither of which had been written at the time. Instead, Jesus leans into what God's priority is. And the shift in this is to understand, in John's Gospel, we would say the priority begins with sin to receive salvation and forgiveness. But in Luke's Gospel, Jesus doesn't begin with sin. He begins with God's grace. And that's a little bit what I want to talk about today. Because the thing is, with John's Gospel, very, very quickly, we can take it from being God's revelation of hope and redemption to a list of rules and laws, ticker boxes, tick, 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 I've been forgiven, tick, confess my sin, tick, repentance, tick, on my way to heaven, tick. And very quickly, we can change what is an encounter with Christ that transforms us from the inside out to a bunch of actions that we can align ourselves with. But in doing so, we don't even need Jesus personally. And as a Christian, can I just say, one of the challenges for Christian parents is as we try and teach and train and form our kids, actually we can lean this direction too. We try and teach them the right way to live. We teach them the redemptive way to live. We teach them the pathway to forgiveness. All good things. But can I say that Jesus didn't just focus on that. He focused on his priority, God's priority, which begins with grace. And I'm going to talk about that in a minute. I just want to say it's much, much easier to teach rules and regulations and formation that way. It's easier to write a dress code than it is to make disciples. But disciple making is about transformation from the inside out. And so Jesus leans into this priority, a priority of grace, as he begins. And as he does, he defines grace by his behavior in that situation. It's not a language thing. He doesn't articulate, well, here's my grace. He embodies grace. And the reason for that is that grace isn't just a word about God. It is his uncoerced initiative and pervasive, extravagant demonstration of care and favor. Michael Horton says, in grace, God gives nothing less than himself. Grace then is not a third thing or a substance mediating between God and sinners like forgiveness is, but it is Jesus Christ in redeeming action. So we note that as this woman comes in, as she weeps, as she wipes Jesus' feet with her hair and kisses his feet and anoints him with oil, that in that space he doesn't remove himself. He doesn't recoil from her. He doesn't think, oh my goodness, if she's kissing my feet, what will everybody else think? He meets her where she is. That is God's grace, the presence of God with us as we are. It's not measured out. It meets us exactly in that space. And if ever you've been loved as you are, you will know what this woman felt. And you may know what everybody else in the room was feeling about that. So before Jesus tackles this woman's need for forgiveness, he meets her where she's at. He couldn't care less about her occupation. He's not worried about her backstory, and he's not worried about his own reputation. There is nothing that this woman can do that would make Jesus love her more. And so in this space, we find the priority of God well before we're resolving and reconciling and repenting. We find God's present with us. And if you've been raised in a place where you've had to step through repentance and confession and sometimes public confession and things like that in a way that has been legalistic, and if people have withheld God's love for you until you've done the right thing, or if you have felt there are hoops to jump and I's to dot and T's to crosses, then look to this story and see how Jesus outlines that God's priority is that you know, as you are right now, God loves you. And there is nothing you can do to earn his love more, exactly as you are. And my hope and my prayer is that God will meet you wherever you are now, meet you where you are at, because that is the unfolding revelation of God's goodness and his grace. And that's what makes this story not a blah, blah, blah story. It's not a casual story. It's not a story we can read over and miss and think, yeah, just Jesus doing his thing. This is a story full of the surprise of grace. So then Jesus moves on to his next action. Simon is poised, waiting to see what will happen. And this is what happens. Jesus answers Simon, who didn't ask a question. Thought a thing, didn't ask a question. I have something to tell you, Simon. Tell me, teacher, he says. Two people owed money to a moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii, the other 50. Neither of them had enough money to pay back. So he forgave the debt of both. Now, which one of them will love him more? What a random story for Jesus in the middle of this very awkward moment. He kind of distracts everybody from the things they think matter, and he draws their attention to God's priority. And curiously, he doesn't just tell a story that kind of explains itself. He tells a story that has a twist. And if you're a comedian, which I am not, apparently that's the key to good comedy, to have a moment of stress and then tell a story, tell an answer that has a twist. So I wonder whether Jesus was stirring into that humour in that space. But Jesus makes his story not about the moneylender's perspective. When he asks the question, so we have a moneylender sharing money with people that can't pay him back, big debt, little debt, forgives both debt. So that's the story from the moneylender's perspective. But Jesus asks a question from those that have been forgiven debts perspective. Who will love him more? What an interesting question. What an interesting place Jesus brings the whole community along with this. Everyone who's sitting in the room all of a sudden is, oh, have to swap perspectives here and wonder what it would be like for each of those people. Jesus draws out of them empathy. They stand in the shoes of those who've been forgiven. And in that moment, they get something they wouldn't have got without this story. They get that it matters, the relationship. It matters not just for the moneylender, but also for the person who has been forgiven. It matters that they can have a relationship two-way, which is how relationships work, isn't it? It's not like a benevolent moneylender, like the government or the whoever might be benevolent above us that we never know, but it is a relationship where the moneylender is forgiving and the person who's been forgiven loves in return. So here is this really interesting idea that invites us to recognise that God's priority, once again, is not just about forgiveness and repentance and these steps through the right hoops, but it's actually about knowing God's grace and actually being able to enter into it and respond with love. So I'm left with a couple of thoughts in the middle of this story before we wrap up. One of them is that Jesus is clearly identifying that this woman is a person who's been forgiven much, and therefore she loves much. And Jesus is helping us see that her actions are actions of love, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But I also wonder whether Jesus is addressing in the room the unspoken things. So my hunch is that Simon was very nervous when a woman, a prostitute, turned up in his house to meet with Jesus. I don't know any of this for sure. There would be no evidence, but I'm suspicious as to what a prostitute would be doing in a house of a person like a Pharisee. I'm more curious to know who let her in. How did she get in? Was it a house she'd been to before? Was she a familiar part of the household currency, if you know what I mean? And I'm wondering whether Simon himself, the whole way through, has had two things going on. One, this woman and her behaviour in Jesus. And two, what will everyone think of this woman being in my home? What will they think about me? Or even more, will they know about me? And I wonder whether as Jesus invites Simon into this perspective, he's also helping Simon own his own response to forgiveness. And he doesn't publicly out Simon. And so I can't be certain that's going on. But I do know that God in his grace will meet us where we're at. And perhaps for Simon, he needed forgiveness too. And perhaps for Simon, the debt was greater than he wanted people to know. And perhaps for Simon, those words became life-giving for him, and he was able to love in return. And I know that just because we're people of God, just because we're Christians, just because we seek to be holy as Christ is holy, I know that the church is full of people that struggle and wrestle with all sorts of different things that we know aren't godly. And so perhaps even today, this story rings for you, and there's an invitation of both grace being met, God is meeting where you're at, and his love for you there, and an opportunity for you to respond to that love. So let's wrap up the story. Verse 43, Simon replies, well, I've got some things going on in his head. I suppose the one who had the bigger debt. You have judged correctly, Jesus said. And then he turned toward the woman and he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I came to your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as great as her great love has shown. But whoever has been forgiven little loves little. And then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. The other guests began to say amongst themselves, who is this who can even forgive sins? And Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Jesus tucks this new thought into the message as the crowd watch on with this object lesson. Accepting forgiveness will change the way we behave. That's the thought. As opposed to changing behaviour will receive forgiveness. Jesus reverses the power of that. He says to Simon, look at this woman. He's looking at her. Look at what she's done. She's done all these things that are acts of love. In contrast, Simon, actually, to you, who has not followed social convention. You haven't washed my feet. You haven't anointed my head with oil. You didn't greet me with a kiss, which was customary then, but is COVID unsafe now, so don't do it. But in the midst of that, Jesus says, what you can see is the fruit of her forgiveness. She's operating out of the overflow of her heart. So what I found interesting about this story as I read it again was that her tears were not tears of shame and sorrow and grief. which is what I expected the first time I read it in a little while. They were tears of joy because she'd been listening. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. She'd been listening. She'd been watching Jesus heal the lepers and heal the lame and the blind and care for those that had been lost in darkness. And as she watched and as she listened and she learned all the ways Jesus shared his gospel good news wherever he went, she began to believe it true for her. And she stepped into it well before she'd come and kissed Jesus' feet. And her tears and her kisses and her perfume were signs of commitment and faith and love and worship. And they were extravagant and they were undignified and they were unreserved. And Jesus took joy in her worship in the middle of that room. And he helped Simon and everybody watching see that when we understand how much God loves us, when we meet with him and he meets with us where we are, when we can experience what it is to receive the favor of God through nothing that we've done, then we are overwhelmed with the joy and love of God. And we respond through worship. And so Jesus highlighted for Simon some steps, some moves that he might need to take into his life as he also experienced the forgiveness and the grace and the love of God. And I find the story a little bit uncomfortable. I find it a little bit challenging. I find it a reminder and a nag in my ears. As I've gotten older, I've become less energized in my worship, more reserved, more dignified, less of the floor sitting and the kneeling and the hand waving, less of the extravagant, undignified, unreserved worship. And maybe I've become less connected with the grace of God, and that I'm not entitled to it because of what I've done or what I do or who I am, but because God chooses to love. And my hunch is I'm probably not alone in that. That for all of us, there is an invitation to remember the favor of God that is placed upon you because he chooses it. And as we remember that, and as we encounter that afresh, to open our hearts in worship and to stop trying to look like good church worshipers, and to become a little bit undignified, like King David, well, maybe not like King David, but in some way, to express our worship unreservedly to God. Well, I hope you've been reminded that God is kinder than we think, that the one shape fits all, that we sometimes want to pull over people as they try and encounter Jesus, actually isn't the only shape Jesus expressed his kindness and his goodness and his grace. And I hope you feel invited to draw near to God, to make some space, to remember who you are because God says you are, who you are because he loves you, because he chooses, and to make some space to open your heart in worship afresh. May God bless you as you go through this week. May you sense his presence in all that's around you, whether it's beautiful environment, the wind and the rain or the sun or whatever, wherever it is you find an expression of God, in the laughter of your children or your grandchildren or your friends or your neighbours. And may you remember in all of these things that God is meeting you where you are and loving you as you are. And may you pass that on to others. Let's pray. We are so grateful for the person of Jesus, in whom the fullness of the Godhead dwelt. It's expression of who you are, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And as we learn and as we draw on this who you are, we're so grateful for your grace. We're so grateful we don't have to earn it. We're so grateful it is you meeting us, your presence, your love in our lives, wherever we are. Refresh our hearts, I pray, Lord. Renew our love, I pray, that we might remember and worship, and the overflow may be that the joy of the Lord is shared with others that we live, laugh, and work with. So I pray this in the name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen. Thanks so much for worshiping with us. God bless you as you go about your day today.
Or whenever you're joining us. Sorry. Welcome to church.
New Church of Christ, we invite you to...
Good morning.
Good afternoon.
Good evening.
All right, I've got it.
No, I said that, good evening, and then you said good night.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe you should do, or whenever you're joining us from...
Welcome to do so now, and our details are here.
Yep. Cool. Also, kids and...
Time to do so. So we invite you to... Now is a great time to present your offering. Give your online giving.
If you're a regular worshiper here at Boronia, both the Church of Christ, now would be a great time to do your online giving. The information you need we found right here on your screen.
Present your online giving. All right, one more time.
I'm finding it hard to not smile in a weird way.
I wanted to be an actor once.
Well, did you?
Give. Please feel free to contact our admin.
You just can't end it, can you?
We don't need to give people options. They can just do it one way.
That's right.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, gosh. Okay, this is it. Let me fold my shirt. This is the problem.
Just finish, conclude with, if it's a problem, deal with it.
Shall we pray?
Let's. You're praying.
Okay. You're praying.
Go on, Kate. Thanks for joining us. I don't know how you meant to end that thing.
Now is the time.